Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
Hey everybody, this is the Digital Asset Investor and I am watching the Georgia Ole Miss game. I got today got away from me because I was went on a fishing trip yesterday. So, but now it is on like Donkey Kong. There's a lot of stuff. Here is what I want to show you first. Brad Garlinghouse was interviewed. This is interesting.
Another token seeing big gains over the past few days is XRP, which has been developed by the digital payment network Ripple. It's currently valued at around $11 billion and is trying to go mainstream by launching its own ETF. However, it's currently involved in a long-standing case with the Securities and Exchange Commission, which is blocking the launch. For more on all this, we're now joined by the CEO of Ripple, Brad Garlinghouse. So welcome, Brad. Let's start with that tweet that you have sent on a crypto checklist to Donald Trump for his first 100 days, including firing SEC Chair Gary Gensler. What are the main things that you want him to address?
Well, as you probably know, Donald Trump has been kind of a crypto advocate and the crypto president by his self-proclamation around that for a number of months during the campaign. And he has actually said that one of the first things he would do in office is to do everything he can do to remove Gary Gensler, who has really waged a war against crypto in the United States. The irony, of course, is many countries around the world, even the UK, Switzerland, Singapore, have really leaned into crypto, created clear rules, which has allowed entrepreneurs and capital to flow in and allow the industry to grow and thrive.
But while Trump is seen as favorable for crypto leaders and investors, does his recent alignment with crypto actually pose some ethical concerns? I mean, he's launched the cryptocurrency project World Liberty Financial. Is this a potential conflict of interest now that he has a stake in the industry, Brad?
You know, I think obviously Donald Trump has stakes in lots of industries, and I think the voters decided that they preferred Donald Trump as opposed to other candidates throughout the process. So I don't really take a position on that. I think there's obviously a lot of disclosure laws, and I think as his second trip to the White House, I'm sure there's plenty of people around him that are experienced with that. I do think, regardless of his own participation in different parts of the economy, we've got to get the United States growing in as it relates to this industry. And the Biden administration, really not just the United States SEC, but other parts of the government as well, have been pretty hostile towards crypto, despite its growth, despite that it's over a $2 trillion market today.
And with a Donald Trump win, are you expecting a resolution in this Ripple versus SEC lawsuit? I mean, this was surrounding whether XRP is considered a security or a digital currency. And what do you think a resolution would mean for the broader crypto industry?
Look, as you probably know, we've been fighting with the SEC for 3.5 years. We won that case last summer. The SEC, the judge in that case declared very explicitly, XRP in and of itself is not a security. The SEC is appealing part of that decision, but importantly, they're not appealing the part of the decision that says XRP is not a security. So we feel very good about that. The law of the land of the United States is that XRP is not a security. What's frustrating, I think, for the whole industry is that only Bitcoin and XRP really have the explicit regulatory clarity in the United States. Other leading cryptocurrencies like ETH and Solana have been a little bit in a fuzzy land. And it's really kind of maddening, and I think madness, to think we're going to litigate every single token one by one. We've been challenging the government, challenging the SEC to create clear rules of the road, as you've seen in the UK, as you've seen in Japan, where they've created taxonomies so that the regulation is clear. And people in the US crypto industry want to follow the rules. We just have to have clarity about what the rules are.
And Brad, talk to us more about clarity that you need in regulation. What more in particular would you like to see?
Well, I think the key thing is the SEC under Gary Gensler has tried to take the position that most cryptocurrencies are securities. Securities, as I think many people know, the law, it's about, you know, rights and title and ownership of a company. If you own a security in Apple, You own part of the company. You have governance rights. You can vote on the board of directors. That obviously doesn't exist. If you own XRP, if you own ETH, if you own different cryptocurrencies, you're not getting the rights and title and interest of a security. So the key really is creating that clarity that the SEC is not the regulator that's trying to kind of own this industry. And they've really been trying to do regulation through enforcement rather than codifying and taking the time to write clear rules of the road.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us there, Brad Gellingham.
All right. Good stuff. Check this out. It says SEC. I've seen this a few times. I have not confirmed it. But it says SEC Chair Gary Gensler will resign as the 33rd chair of the U.S. Securities Exchange Commission by the end of December, according to an anonymous source. So we've got an anonymous source, which is a thumbnail. Let's see. Anonymous source. Okay, that's a thumbnail. Then we've got this. This is Ron Hammond. He was with Thinking Crypto talking about this very topic.
To your point, he would probably have to either resign now or before the Trump is inaugurated, or he would be gone pretty much when Trump's inaugurated day one. So they probably have an acting chair. I mean, I imagine it would probably be someone who's like current commissioner. My mind goes to Mark Ueda, but I can see Hester Peirce too as well. Being in that kind of temporary role. And again, you have to remember, there'll be a 2-2 split there, two Republicans, two Democrats, likely. So nothing's going to probably get done too consequential in that kind of holding pattern period until someone's confirmed by the Senate. And that's going to be the big marker there. And, you know, there have been a couple names thrown out for who's the SEC chair. Again, you also have to look at the other agencies like Treasury, OCC, CFTC, and stuff like that. So, but the good thing about Trump, at least for this go around, is that he does have a pretty, it seems like now, going to be hefty Republican majority. And so, you know, one or two votes tanking his nominations like they did over 4 years ago, he's not going to run into that situation, it seems like, as much. So, but it remains to be seen. Trump could also change his mind and do something a little more controversial at the last second. But it seems from all the names we're hearing that they've been preparing for this for quite some time. So I think they're going to hit the ground running, and it's going to go pretty dang fast, especially with a Republican Congress.
Oh, sure. Is it possible for Hester Peirce to, aside from the temporary chair role, become the permanent chair and then some additional commissioners are thrown in the mix? Or it's not possible because she's already a commissioner and she can't be promoted to that? I don't know how this all works.
No, you can be promoted. And she would still have to go through the same nomination process and such. And so, and you have to fill in someone else's spot. So almost in a sense, it's almost double duty where you have to replace, you know, go through the nomination for herself and then go through, replace it for someone else to take her commissioner slot. So it's in the realm of possible.
I do not want Hester Peirce. She is not an alpha, not the way she's acted all these years. Oh, I disagree. I really disagree with Gary Gensler, and that's about all we got out of her. She could have blown the whistle. Or she's not an alpha, but as my sons would say, she's not a sigma. That's what they always talk about. I don't even know why. Now, check this out. Cardano, Charles Hoskinson, touted for crypto advisor role under Donald Trump. Now, I think that Donald Trump and his people need to watch this before they make that decision. Watch this right here, okay? From right here, and I want you to listen very closely to what Stephen Nerioff says, because I think many people missed it.
Who wins? That's the question here. Who wins?
Who wins? Who won in ETHgate?
Because I think China wins.
Charles said that Chinese...
He just said Charles said that Chinese... Have been courting Vitalik hard. So, Charles Hoskinson had knowledge of Chinese wanting to co-opt Ethereum. Is that what I just heard? Is that who we want as a crypto advisor? You know, the guy whose company is IOHK, Input Output Hong Kong. What's his affiliation with the Chinese? That's my question. I also wanted to remind everybody of this, because back when Elon Musk said this, while we were uncovering ETHgate, he was not working with Donald Trump, at least publicly. I don't know what he was doing behind the scenes, but he says, remember when they said this? This was back Where's the date? December 21, 2021. Has anyone seen Web 3? I can't find it. When you hear Web 3, you think Ethereum, folks. Jack Dorsey says it's somewhere between A and Z. And then Elon Musk says M something something. And I don't know what this M something something means. If anybody out there knows what M something something means, please let me know. Because I want to know. Okay. I'm going to skip this one. This guy's talking about how Ethereum is the contrarian play. I want to show you this one. This is him talking about Bitcoin.
Yeah, and it's great to have you. And when you're probably asked as much as I am, if Bitcoin's going to 100,000 next, what would you say?
Kelly, happy Friday. I think Bitcoin's going to hit all-time highs. It hit them today, and I think it's going further, right? My basic premise is that ultimately Bitcoin's value will be half of that of all the gold outstanding. So you're talking about something like $300,000 for Bitcoin.
Why only half the value? Why not a quarter of the value or pick some other random number?
Well, because maybe I'm more balanced. I think if I were Bitcoin maximalist, I would say it would overtake gold. But I think that's like a reasonable base assumption. It's clear. You know, one of the big winners this year is individual investors have really piled into the Bitcoin ETFs. And I think as individuals, as a constituency, they were important in this election. The loss by Sherrod Brown of his Ohio Senate seat, the fact that Trump went to the Bitcoin convention shows that there's a big constituency in the U.S. And hopefully it becomes a bipartisan issue as well, not so one-sided.
All right, now, finally, I wanted to I'll play a little bit of this. This is CFTC Commissioner Caroline Pham. She's sharing the potential steps for a new administration.
They have spoken, and they want to see people with real-world business experience in Washington. I think that's why you see the markets rally.
By the way, Stuart Alderotti mentioned that he and Ripple had met with Donald Trump in San Francisco last summer. She also has met with them as well.
Because there's a hope that there's going to be people with deeper
Trump
understanding
2.0.
Of the markets, of market fundamentals, of the international trade situation, and what that means for the balance of power between the U.S. and the rest of the world. So I think that's what that means. And I think importantly in the crypto space, what it means is no more regulation by enforcement, that America needs to go back to embracing innovation, and we need to be forward-looking like we are here in Singapore, and be focused on what can we do to provide regulatory clarity now or today. And that's why I've proposed a U.S. regulatory sandbox in the past that we've talked about. And that's something that we can do now, we can do today. The MAS stood up their regulatory sandbox in 2018. It's time for us to do these pilot programs now. And the GMAC has been putting forward proposals as well to provide that regulatory clarity. Tokenized collateral proposal is coming up on November.
Okay, we don't have to get bogged down in all that. You see the point. CFTC is coming in to help as well. Now, in DAIXRP.com, here's what we're going to talk about. There are people running scared that should be running scared. We're going to talk about it is wild, some of the stuff we're seeing going on now. And these people, they're about to get, well, you know what they call it, they effed around and they're about to find out. These people are criminals, and they're getting what's coming to them, and you can see it forming, and it is oh so glorious to watch. And I'm going to show you some of what's going on. I'm the digital asset investor. I'm not an investment advisor. This is for entertainment purposes only. Please subscribe, hit the like button, tell your friends and family. It is finally on like Donkey Kong. Here we go.